host. The host is usually the larger one. So the relationships between the host and parasite is called parasitism. Parasitology means the study of the parasites, different aspects of parasites. Medical parasitology means studying the parasites related to human health. So this course is medical parasitology. During the course, we are going to study different aspects of parasites, geographical distribution, epidemiology, route of transmission to human, life cycle, clinical symptoms, diagnosis, principle of prevention and control, and also treatment for every medically important parasites. Okay, when I say parasites and host, the human is a host for the parasites. Parasites, in the life cycle, 10 means parasites, have larval stage and adult stage. When I say adults, it means they have reproductive system. When I say larvae, it means they don't have reproductive systems. They won't have reproductive system called definitive host. Definitive host, when the adult stage happens in a host, this host is called definitive. But in any host, if larval stage happens, we call intermediate host. For some parasites, human is definitive host, for others as intermediate host. So any parasites I'm going to mention, for each one I'm going to tell you either human is definitive host, it means if the adult is living in human, or human act as intermediate host, it means the larval stage happening in human. Right. Traditionally, medical parasitology is divided into three sections: protozoa, protozoology, hematology, and arthropod. Okay? You know about the protozoa and parasites. And we are going to start about hemis parasites from today. And after that, at the final of the course, you are going to have some session about arthropods acting as the parasites of human. Especially they act as ectoparasites. Protozoan parasites and hemis parasites are endoparasites. It means they are living inside of the body. But ectoparasites means they are living on the skin or on the hair of human. Alright? Right. In the helminthology, medically important helminths can be divided either based on the morphology. Do you know what it means, morphology?
Yes,
structure, appearance of the parasites. Or by the route of transmission. Okay? In the parasitological case, the basis of morphology is used. And also the program of parasitology you have is based on the morphology. It means we start, for example, for a group of helminths based on morphology and so on. But the other one, which is based on the transmission to human, it is recommended by a World Health Organization or WHO. This classification is important in the control of the helminth parasites. Based on the morphology, we have two phylum, the medically important helminths, I mean, not all helminths. The medically important helminths are first divided to two phylums. The first one is platy helminths. Platy means, for example, like this one, this is platy. Platin is platin. Platin helminths are called platy helminths. The other phylum, which is called nematohelminths, like this one, they are cylindrical in shape. Okay? They call nematohelminths. The other name for nematohelminths is rhomber. Do you know why a cylindrical helminth is called rhomber? Can you guess why?
Because of morphology.
exactly, because in this section, they are wrong. No, this is nematohelminth. In this section, they are wrong, so the other name for nematodes is wrong verbs. So we have two phylum, phylum platyhelminths and phylum nematohelminths. Platyhelminths are all flat-ended, but nematohelminths are cylindrical. There are two main differences between platyhelminths and nematohelminths. In the nematohelminths, as you see here, we have a picture with two parasites. One is male, the other one is female. It means they are, the male and female are separate. Actually, they are dioecious. It means for each parasite, we have two different male and female for nematodes. But for the platyhelminths, they are divided to two groups, actually two classes. Class of trematodes or trematoda and class of cestoda. In the cestoda, which they are called tapeworms, tapeworms, all of them are hermaphrodite. Do you know hermaphrodite? What it means? Yes, for in every natural prokaryotic of tapeworms, there are both male and female reproductive systems. So every single tapeworm has both male and female reproductive system. They are hermaphrodite. All the cystos which have medical importance. Okay? About the other one. They are called trematodes or flukes. Flukes is the other name of the trematodes. In the trematodes, there's just one group which called schistosoma species. In schistosoma species, they are flattened, but they have male and female. Other trematodes are hermaphrodite, like this one. Sphenodontatheca is an example for the trematodes. As you see, it is one single trematode. It means fasciola is hermaphrodite. In every single fasciola, adult fasciola, there's both male and female reproductive system. This is related to reproductive system. The other difference is related to the. If you have any question, you can ask me during the session, no problem. Anytime you need, you drop me and ask your question.
What was the trematoda group? Schistosoma?
Schistosoma species are a group of trematodes which male and female are separate, but other trematodes. When I say SPP, it means species. Different species. You have one special session about schistosoma because they are important trematodes, but they have male and female. But other trematodes like fasciola are hermaphrodite. The other important difference is related to the alimentary canal. Actually, cestodes doesn't have any alimentary canal. They don't have mouth, they don't have intestine. So what do you think how they can absorb nutrients? They don't have any mouth, they don't have any intestine. So such parasites, how they can absorb the nutrients from the host?
Diffusion?
No.
Endocytosis.
Diffusion that is happening in the body, but how they absorb through the outer layer of the body, which is called especially a special name because it is very active, it is called tegument. Tegument. Tegument is the name of. She's my colleague, Dr. Fakir, tomorrow in the practical. So the outermost layer of the cystoid and also telomatose, which is useful in absorption of the nutrient, is called tegument. So the cystoid don't have any alimentary canal. The absorption of the nutrients from the house is through the outermost layer of the body, which is called tegument. But for the telomatose, they have mouths, pharynx, and then it is divided, bifurcated, but they don't have any ends. Okay? They have incomplete alimentary canal. It means they don't have any ends. Okay?
Primitive.
Yes. But for the nematodes, they have complete alimentary canal from mouth, esophagus, intestine, and at the end of the nematodes, they have anus. So this is the last important difference between nematodes and platyhelminths. For each one, I have provided an example. This is just an example. For example, for telomatodes, the example is Farcillaria aquatica, one of the most important telomatodes. For the cystoid, the example is Tinea saginata, that today we are going to talk about next session. And for nematodes, Ascaris lumberi, please. Right, I told you there's another means of classification for medically important helminths provided by World Health Organization. Based on the transmission to human, we have five groups of helminths. The first one is snake-transmitted helminths. Snake-transmitted helminths, it means in the life cycle of the parasites, presence of helminths as intermediate host is necessary. All such parasites, helminths, use one species, a specific species, as intermediate host. Okay? Actually, all the trematodes, like Fasciola that I mentioned, or Schistosoma species, and other trematodes, all of them use snake as intermediate host. It means the development of larval stage happens in snake. In this group, we are going to study Schistosoma species, Fasciola species, Dicrosoria, Chelonorchis, Opistorchis, Paragonimus, Petrophis, Fasciolosis. Don't worry if I mention too many names. I know parasitology has too many names, and it is difficult for any students at the beginning you are going to listen, okay? So it is not just your problem. But we are going to repeat them, especially the ones are important. For each important, we are going to have a specific session about life cycle. Tomorrow you are going to have the parasites. Okay? So it will be repeated, and the important thing is in the exam you are not going to write the name in the theoretical exam. You just need to check the correct answer. But for the practical among the most important species, you need to write the name of the sample you are going to see under the microscope. So the important species will be repeated several times and you will get familiar with the name of the parasites. Don't worry if you hear, and this is the problem for all the students. Right. The other group are meat-transmitted helminths. It means human get infected after eating contaminated meat of animal. For example, cattle, pig, wild animals, okay? In this group, we have Tinea species that we are going to talk about today, Trichinella species, and diphyrobotryum. Actually, when I say meat-transmitted pyrimidines, we have tinea, which is among cestodes. Trichinella is a nematode, and this is also diphyrobotryum cestodes. So when I say root of transmission, we have, may have both nematode and cestode. It's not related to the morphology. The third group are soul-transmitted helminths. It means part of the development of the parasite happens in the soil. For example, when somebody is infected with Ascaris lupercoides, the adult lives in the small intestine of the human. Eggs are excreted in environment. They are not infectious soon after the oviposition. They need to pass 2-3 weeks in suitable environment to be infectious for other people after the development of the larva inside the egg. So they are called soul-transmitted helminths. Soul-transmitted helminths are more prevalent in tropical and subtropical areas. In this group, the other name for soul-transmitted helminths is geohelminths. In this group, we have Ascaris lumbricoides. We have hookworms, including Ankylostoma duodenal, Necator americanus, Strongyloides estercolaris, Trichostrongylus species, and Trichiris trichira. All of these are soul-transmitted helminths. Humans get infected when they are in the close contact with the contaminated soil. People who are working in the soil or children who play in the soil, they are at the risk of infection. The next group are direct transmitted helminths. It means presence of intermediate host in the life cycle is not necessary. They don't necessarily need intermediate host. They don't need to spend some time in environment. When somebody is infected, for example, when a child is infected with Enterobius vermicularis, eggs soon after the release are infectious for the same person or for other person in the family or in the any group they are working in. So direct transmitted helminths is related to personal hygiene and are more prevalent in children. More prevalent in children. The last group.
So, ma'am, does that mean direct transmitted helminths have only definitive host? Only definitive?
You know, they have larval stage, but larvae and adults are in the same person.
Uh-huh.
It means that
the same entity acts as both.
Yes,
intermediate.
The same as both. The house has both adult stage and larval stage, so they act in definitive house and intermediate. Yes, good question. The last group is arthropod transmitted helminths. In this group, we have, for example, Guinea worm, the actually scientific name is Dromophilus medinensis. We expect after an infectious disease which has been eradicated in the world. This is to be the second. What infectious disease has been already prevalent in the world, but at the moment it is eradicated? You know the name?
What name?
There was an infectious disease when I was a child. It was prevalent in the world, okay, and we were vaccinated with that actual organism. But at the moment, it is eradicated from all of the world.
Smallpox.
Smallpox, exactly. So it is, and it is expected after the smallpox, Dropbox medicines to be second infectious disease, which we expect to be eradicated from all of the world. It is transmitted through the water. It provides safe water without the intermediate host. Intermediate hosts are Cyclops species across the ocean. Cyclops species. If you provide safe water, it will be eradicated. So, okay? So you don't have this parasite in your countries. Even you had before, it is not eradicated. We just have some small parasite in the Central Africa, as they say. There are some other, you have questions? There are some other.
How is jasmine? Arthropod.
Arthropod. Do you know what means arthropod? For
insects.
Example, insects are one group of arthropods.
Exactly.
Insects, crustaceans. Okay. Arthropod acts as intermediate parts for such parasites. For example, in first group we have a snake. A snake are intermediate parts. But in this group, some insects, for example, anopheles species, you've heard about them, Phoenix species, okay? Even Cyclops species, they acting as intermediate host for next group of the enemies. So in addition to cucumber, we have some filarial nematodes. They are delicate, large nematodes. They are living in the blood or lymphatic tissues of human. We have some special session about filarial nematodes. So, because some of them may be important in your do we have any one from India?
Yes.
Yes, you know, in India we have filarial bantrophy, which is among filarial nematodes, okay?
Yes.
We have some specific session about
very common here.
Yeah. We had a patient several years ago, we had a patient from India. He was working in Iran, and he had gonorrhea. When we referred to my lab, we find that he is infected with Shigella. Right. Now, we are going to study area of each this group. Okay? First, we are going to study about cestodes. Today, I'm going to tell you the most important cestodes in human. Right. In the cestodes, which the main other name is tapeworms, they have different orders, right? They have different orders. Two orders are important in medicine. Order Saprophilida, okay? The other one is Pseudophilida. The most important, medically important species are in the first group, Saprophilida. In this group, we have Tinea species, the Chiacomus species, Hydralicus species. In the Pseudophilida, we have Diphyllobotryum species. One of the most important is Diphyllobotryum gadu, and Spirometra species. Let's see what is the difference between Saprophilidian cestodes and Pseudophilidian cestodes. They have both morphological difference and difference in the life cycle. Morphologically, the most important aspects. In the Saprophilidian, the scolex means head. Scolex means head. Head of the cestode is called scolex, okay? In the scolex, all of them have four suckers. All the Saprophilidian have four suckers in the scolex. them, in addition of their scolex, have hoops. Most of them. The number of hoops and the rows of the hoops is important. But in the pseudophilidia, they don't have scolex, but all adult systems needs attachment organ. Needs attachment organ. Can you tell me why, based on the introduction I told you about the cystoids, why the cystoids needs attachment organ?
For the absorption of food through the surface.
Absorption of attachment in the intestine. All the cystoids as the adult stage, not larval stage. All the cystoids as adult stage live in the intestine of definitive host. Because they don't have any alimentary canal, the best organ they can live in and absorb the nutrition is intestine. So they are in the intestine. They need attachment organ. Otherwise, they would remove. Okay? So the attachment organ for this group are suckers, four suckers, in addition of most of the hooks. But in the pseudophilidia, they don't have suckers. Instead of suckers, they have two grooves, which is called botria. This groove is called botria. By the aid of botria, or suckers, or hooks, the scolex of cystoids will firmly attach to the intestine of definitive house. And they can live for some species even 30 years. For 30 years, for some species, the scolex, the scolex and neck region remain in the intestine of definitive host for several years, depending on the species, but in some species, they live for 3 decades. Alright?
Khana, you said that it takes food by the outer layer tegument, okay?
Yeah.
How it take food, like by diffusion or by endocytosis? By which process it takes?
Actually, they have mitochondria in the tegument,
okay.
And they absorb by the aid of mitochondria and the microtubes. I'll show you the slides, okay?
Will you repeat botria? What does that mean?
Botria means the sucking groove. The sucking groove is called botria. Botria is the name of this. As this is called sucker,
this is
called botria.
Cycolites, cystolites.
Sacrophilidia, pseudophilidia.
They are for attachment material.
Both botria and suckers are attachment organ. You see, this is the outermost layer of the cystoids. You see, this is the intestine of an infinity pulse, for example, human. This is an adult cystoid. This is the scolex. By the scolex, they attach to the intestine. This part, if you look to the tegumen, in the tegumen, this is for a schematic view, higher magnification. Here we have specific structure which are called microtubes. Microtubes expanding the surface area of the tegument. Actually, they help the absorption of the nutrients from the intestine of the definitive host. And in this part, we have cells, syncytial cells, which help the absorption through the nutrition and diffusion.
Whole outer surface acts as tegument?
Whole have tegument. Whole the surface layer has tegument. It means the absorption is not just through the scolex. Actually, scolex is the attachment. from one human, what it is happening. So the size is evaluated from a few millimeters up to several meters, depending on the species, okay? But anyone, any cystose, just from a millimeter or several meters, they have three most important in their body, important parts in the body.
Excuse me, teacher. Are these cyclophilidae and pseudophilia, you can differentiate it on the basis of just attachment organ?
The most important is attachment hormone. They have other differences in the, especially adult stage, in the segments, in the reproductive system, yes. But I told you the most important difference, because when I say scolex is actually both in the larval stage and adult stage. But when I say about the reproductive system, you don't see any reproductive system in the larva. But in the larva, you can see the scolex. The most important is the scolex. But in the life cycle, the difference in the cyclophilidae and the life cycle is only happening in the terrestrial species. The host are living in the ground, okay? Terrestrial. But in the pseudophilia, there are some part of the life cycle happening in the water. This is the difference in the life cycle. Right, the size I told you is variable, but any size, the scolex is, and the cystoid is, they have three most important parts in their body. The scolex, and then the neck. Neck has germinal cells. The germinal cells is important because they produce segments. The segments close to the neck is called immature. It means they don't have reproductive system. The middle segments are called mature. It means in every single mature segment or proglottid, okay, they are the same. In the every single proglottid, they have both male and female reproductive system. For example, this part, you are asked the question, this part in the pseudophilidia and cyclophilidia is regular, but it just only adult, you can see the segments, mature segments. This yellow part is related to female reproductive system, and pink part is related to male. All right? And this is the genital pore. The place of genital pore in the segment is important. Is it central? Is it lateral? If it is lateral, it is regular or is it irregular? Okay? The place of the genital pore is important in the diagnosis of the palsy. Okay, so the middle segments are called mature. In the middle segments,
genital pore is immature?
No, I mean the middle segments. The middle segments are every cystos are called mature. Mature, it means they have reproductive system. Fertilization can happen in the mature proglottid.
So it possesses genital pore, am I right?
For them?
It have genital pore?
This genital pore is, you know, for example, this proglottid is mature. They have both male and female reproductive system. When the size of the program cystoid is large, for example, several meters, usually it is just one adult. It's not possible. If it is too many, it leads to the death of the patients. If the patient died, the parasite will die. The parasites are more successful that do not kill the host, okay? So when one adult is happening in a small intestine host, one proglottid can have fertilization with other proglottids. Even in one single proglottid, fertilization can happen. For example, these are the testes, this is vas deferens, from here the sperms are released, okay? And this is the vagina. So they can fertilize the oocytes in here, in the ovary, okay? the ovum will reach to the uterus. When the uterus is full of eggs, this is called graviprogloptic. Graviprogloptic, it means there's just uterus and the eggs, because they don't need the other reproductive system. They have produced the eggs, okay? So, if there are several cestodes, for example, we have cestodes made echinococcus, they are just a few millimeters. So, thousands and thousands cestodes can happen in the intestine of one house. This is part of the intestine, a small intestine of a dog, heavily infected with Echinococcus granulosus. Every white spot is one adult Echinococcus granulosus. When there's several adult cestodes, one adult can have fertilization with others. Did that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So, the three main part of the adult cestode is scolex, neck, and estrobilum. When I say estrobilum, it means whole chain of proglottids. The proglottids are immature, mature, and gravid. The last proglottids are gravid, full of eggs. Okay. If the proglottids is thick,
and each proglottid can lead to maturation of egg or they can produce egg. Did you repeat? Each segment can produce egg?
Yes.
Simultaneously?
Each proglottis is the last terminal proglottis will be full of eggs. Everyone. Gravid proglottis. This is the uterus and all these branches, all these dark parts of eggs. For example, one gravid proglottis of Tinea sagittata may have 100,000 eggs. Every single. So they produce new proglottids. If the proglottid, gravid proglottid, is tiny, they rupture in the intestine, okay, and the eggs are released in the feces if it is tiny. But if they are thick, like Tinea species, the last terminal proglottids will detach from the end of the cestodes. And the proglottids move out of the body. The proglottids move out. Okay? So, anyhow, when the proglottids full of eggs or the eggs are released in the environment, inside the eggs there's an embryo. Okay? So, every single egg has an embryo. When these eggs are released in the environment, the eggs are eaten by intermediate house. This was the definitive house. The house have the adult stage we call definitive house. From the definitive house, eggs are released in environment. When the eggs with an embryo form with six hooklets, which is called oncosphere. The embryo is called oncosphere. Which has six hooklets. The oncosphere has the membrane to be protected from the environmental condition, right? When the eggs is eaten by intermediate house, the larval stage develops, the larval stage develops in the internal tissues of intermediate house. Okay. We have a general term which is called metacestode. Metacestode is the larval stage of cestode. It is a general term for all the cestodes. But for each species, according to the structure of the cestode, they have also a specific name. And I'll tell you for each one infected with the larval stage of the cystoid, when this mustard is eaten by definitive host, the larvae will develop to the adult stage only in the intestine. So the adult of the cystoids are just live in the intestine of definitive host, but the larvae can happen in different tissues. For example, in the muscles, in the heart, in the liver, in the lung, in the brain, and so on. So the larvae in the different tissues, but all the adults just in the intestine of definitive host. Next, I'll show you a clip related to the oocosphere. You can then suppose how this embryo develops in the intermediate host. This is the egg of the cystoid, Saprophyllidian cystoid, which has an embryo. This is the embryo, you know. This is the booklets, okay? Embryo with the booklets. This is the inner layer, this is the outer layer. This is the inner layer of embryo. This is the outer layer, and the part which moves is the embryo. This is the moving, is embryo. Actually, the booklets help the embryo penetrate the intestinal wall of the definitive host. All right? By the aid of enzyme and also physical activity of the embryo with booklets, they penetrate the intestinal of the intermediate host. So, when the eggs are released in the environment, these eggs with the embryo I just showed you penetrate the intestinal wall of the intermediate host and then develop to the larval stage, which is called the metacystoid. Here just I want to show you the difference between the size. We have cystoids just a few millimeters. When the size is small, so too many can live in intestinal the definitive house, like this one, the Pinococcus granulosus. But when the size is several meters, like Tinea species, Diphyllodetron species, usually there's just one adult, right? But all of them have scolex, neck, and strobila. The scolex and neck are important for the treatment of the disease. For the successful of the treatment, the anti-helminthic drug used need to affect on the scolex and neck region. Otherwise, they produce new segments. If we give the patient an anti-helminthic drug that just affect on the part of the strobilum and the scolex and neck region remains in the body, they produce new segments. Because the neck region is germinal layer, so if we want to have actually complete treatment,
neck and scolex,
the anti-helminthic drugs we use should affect on this part. Scolex and neck, either result to the disruption or deattachment. Deattachment. All right. I showed you the eggs, the oocosphere, and this is a general view of metacystoid. Metacystoid is the. Do you have a question?
Scolex is immature.
Scolex is head.
Head.
Head. It is both in the larval stage and adult stage. Scolex is head. Mature or images is related to the same.
In the neck.
You know? This is the, here, this is the scolex. They are both in the adult stage and larvae, but not in the oocosphere. In the adult and in the larvae. Here is the neck. The segments close to the necks are immature. The segments are immature. It means they don't have reproductive system yet. The middle segments are called mature and the terminal ones are gland. Is it clear?
Yes.
Teacher, can we get an example of intermediate host?
Yes, I'm going to take this one. Y by one. Yes. Right. Let's move to the cestodes which infects human. That was just a general description of the cestode. It was an introduction so far. Okay. We have two groups of cestodes. The cestodes that adults are happening in human, so human acts as definitive host, and the cestodes which act as in human as larval stage. So human is intermediate host. Okay. These are the most. Yeah.
And yes, you talked about there are some hooks also present.
In some species, in addition of the suckers, they have hooks.
Yeah.
I tell you for each one, don't be worried.
Mm-hmm.
For each species, I'm going to about the hooks. Hooks is just the structure of the spolex.
Like I was telling, when an egg is released, how will it attach? Like if it does not have any attachment surface, like.
They don't attach, they penetrate the intestinal wall. When the egg is eaten, the egg has inner layer and outer layer. These layers help the embryo to be has to environment until to be eaten by definitive host. When the egg is eaten, digested as the effect of enzyme in the intestine, okay, the embryo will released by the aid of hooklets, six hooklets, and also the enzyme inside the embryo, they penetrate the intestinal wall, okay, and migrate to different tissues by the circulation or by the lymphatic vessels.
Alright?
This is the list of most important cestodes that the adults happens in human. The most important cestode. Excuse me, this is the last. The most important cestode that larvae happen in human. So when I say larvae, so it means human act as intermediate. Okay. This is the name of the adult. The name of the adult. Echinococcus granulosus. Echinococcus granulosus is one of the most important cestodes in medicine because it is very dangerous, it is highly prevalent, it is prevalent in all of the countries. In any country you are coming from, you have this problem. You have this problem in Iran, neighboring countries, in India, okay? So Echinococcus granulosus, as I showed you earlier, this one. This is Echinococcus granulosus. This is part of the small intestinal duct infected with Echinococcus granulosus. The larval stage, I told you, metacestode is a general thing, but we have a specific name for the larvae of each cestode. The larva, Echinococcus granulosus, is called hydatid cyst. Hydatid cyst is the name of the larvae of Echinococcus granulosus. And I'm going to tell you the details in the later slides, okay? The disease in human is called cystic echinococcosis. Do you know what is the disease? Oesis means disease, okay? Echinococcosis means disease due to echinococcus. Cystic echinococcosis is the disease by Echinococcus granulosus, or the other name for the disease is hydatid cyst. Hydatid cyst or hydatidosis or cystic echinococcosis, all of them is the name of the disease related to echinococcus. This part, the larvae, happens in human. So I'm going to tell you in about the disease, and tomorrow I'm showing to show you the practical related to this disease, because it is one of the most important cystos, actually one of the most important health-related disease in the world, right? The other cysto is called Echinococcus multilocularis. Echinococcus multilocularis is another tiny cysto, just a few millimeters, even smaller than Echinococcus granulosus. They are living in the small intestine of fox and other canids like dog, wolf, jackal, okay? The distribution, geographical distribution of Echinococcus multilocularis compared to granulosus is restricted. We have Echinococcus granulosus in all the continents in the world, but Echinococcus multilocularis is just only in the north hemisphere, right? So they are like other cystos, and as an adult they are living in the smaller definitive host, which are connected. The larval stage is called alveolar echinococcus. The larvae is called alveolar cyst. Alveolar cyst. The disease is called alveolar echinococcus. Okay? This disease is the most lethal health-related disease.
In human, right?
Yes, in human. The most lethal. If the patients get infected with disease, they either die or they may have to have liver transplantation, or they have to take anti-hemolytic drugs for all of their life. So it is the most important, lethal health-related disease, all of those are. Right, the next cystoid is Tinea soli.
Is it direct transmitted, Tinea soli?
Just there's one cystoid in human which is direct transmitted, named hymenoleptostoma. Hymenoleptostoma is the only cystoid which happens in human by direct transmission. All other cystoids are indirect. It means all of them have separate, actually,
intermediate house. But you have wrote their definitive host.
Yeah.
So I'm going to explain. Tinea soli, the adult are in human. And human is so far the only definitive host. It means they are living in small intestine of human. Human is the only definitive host. The natural intermediate host are pigs. But human, for this disease, is also susceptible to the larval stage. So, for Tinea soli, human is both may be infected with the adult intestine, or intermediate stage, which is called cysticercosis. So, cysticercosis means the disease by the larva of Tinea soli. I'm going to tell you this part in the next session, I'm going to dedicate. So I'm just here mentioning the name of the disease. Here you are just going to be familiar with the name of the disease related to the larval stage of cystoids. There are some tinea species in animals. There are very rare cases which largely happens in human. Actually, these are the tinea species in carnivores. The larvae are in the herbivores, but sometimes humans also get infected with the larvae of this. For example, senoriosis is a disease by the larvae of some tibia species, which actually affecting on the brain of the sheep. Sometimes sheep get infected with senoriosis and they have deafness, right? They cannot move properly, all right? So there are very rare cases related to some tinea species which happens between carnivores, canids, and herbivores. In the pseudophilia, all of these so far are cyclophilidian cystoids. About the pseudophilidia, we have pseudophilidian cystoids which in adults happening in human, mostly Diphyllobacterium ladum. But there are a genus which is called Spirometra. Spirometra have several species, okay? in the carnivores, in the intestinal carnivores, intermediate host are snake, frog. In any geographical areas, which people use frog and snake as a nutritional source, they are at the risk of infectivity with the larvae of Spirometra. The disease is called Spirogonisis. Can you mention to me some countries which use snake?
China.
Spirogonisis is prevalent in China, in Vietnam, any part that either eating a snake and frog or traditionally in some rural areas, do you know about that? They believe putting the flesh of the frog on the wound will release the pain. So if the flesh is infected with the larvae of the Spirometra, the penetrate will do the wound, all right? So, for example, in Iran, we have the Spirometra in Bayram, but we don't have so far any case of infectivity of human because in Iran they don't use snakes or frog as a source of the nutrition.
Hana? Human is intermediate host?
For this group, for Spirometra species, human acting as intermediate host. Yes.
And the first one, Echinococcus
granulosa. All of these are the disease due to the larvae. So human is intermediate host.
Okay.
Yes. Let's move this to the cestode, which human act as infinitive host. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Right. These are the list of the cestodes which happens in human as adult stage. All of them are living in the intestine of human. Thymia saginata. Thymia saginata is one of the most actually important cestodes which adults live in human, so human is the primitive host. The other is Thymia solium. Thymia solium use human as definitive host. The larvae usually happens in pig, and wild animals. But human in this case is also susceptible to the larvae of the Thymia solium. There's another species of Thymia, which is called Thymia striatica. As its name is showing, it is mainly in the Eastern Asian countries. Actually, it has been named after utilization of molecular methods like PCR in the phylogeny of Helminths. So it is a new name to Helminths. We had before Thymia saginata and Thymia solium. For the first time in Taiwan, by molecular methods, they found that Thymia, which is nearly between Thymia saginata and solium. First, they called that Thymia Taiwan. But after that, paleontologists find it is present in China, in Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia. So the name changed to Thymia striatica. Okay. So, Hymenolepis nana is the only cestode that both adult and larvae develop in intestinal human, both adult and larvae. So human acts as both definitive host and intermediate host. That's the only cestode. So it is direct transmitted. So both adult in the small intestine, also the larvae penetrate to the intestinal mucosa. So the larval stage is developing intestinal mucosa, not in the, for example, liver or in internal tissues, like other cestodes, no. There's another Hymenolepis, which is called Hymenolepis diminuta, which is rare in human. Hymenolepis nana is actually the most prevalent cestodes in the world, the most prevalent. liver and fistula. Why? Based on the explanation I told you.
Direct transmission.
Exactly. Because it is direct transmitted, so it is the most prevalent. Also, both adult and larvae can develop in human, but sometimes it is possible the larvae develop in actually invertebrates. The next one, which is Hymenolepis diminuta, compared to the nana, it is very rare. Can you guess why Hymenolepis diminuta compared to Hymenolepis nana? It is the rare cases in human.
Because it is not direct transmitted.
They are, yes, they use arthropods as intermediate host. It means presence of the arthropods in the life cycle as a Hymenolepis diminuta is necessary. For infectivity of human should digest an arthropod, for example, beetle, infected with the larvae. So it is usually accidental. Yes? It is very accidental, especially in children. When children play, they meet a beetle.
Also China maybe.
Yes. So Hymenolepis diminuta is very rare cases. All these first five are among saprophilid ancestors. This is pseudophilidia. I told you Spirometra is pseudophilidia, but the larvae happens in human. Dipolypodial species are pseudophilidia, which adults happens in human. One of the species which is more famous is called Dipolypodial ladon. Dipolypodial ladon is a pseudophilidia tapeworms, which adults happens in human, so they are living in the small intestine of human. So let's move to the actually description of every cestode which are important in the medicine. So for each one I'm going to tell you about distribution, the name of the disease, the life cycle, the clinical features in human, and the diagnosis, treatment, and also the control and prevention measures. I told you the larva of Echinococcus granulosus is called hydatid cyst. The disease is called cystic echinococcosis or hydatid cystic. Actually, you know what is the name term of zoonotic or zoonosis?
Yes.
In human and animals. So, hydatidosis is a zoonotic disease. Zoonotic disease and neglected. There's a list of neglected tropical disease that some pediatric disease are included in. Like hydatidosis. Okay. So, Echinococcus is actually a genus. Genus, they have different species. The species which may infect human are Echinococcus granulosus, Echinococcus multilocularis. There's two other species named Echinococcus vogeli and Echinococcus oligarchus. These last two, are so far only in human, or also in the wildlife, have been reported in Central and South America, just in Central and South America. And human cases are very rare. Both definitive host and intermediate host are in the wildlife. So that's the reason that human cases is very rare. So I'm not going to the detail of these two species because they are very rare. The geographical distribution is restricted. The disease is also called neotropical echinococcosis. When we say neotropical, it means related to echinococcosis. chronic focus vigilantly or a chronic focus oligarchus. And also they are, especially vigilantly, leads to polycystic. Polycystic, it means several cysts at the same time in the patient. So that's enough for these two species. But we want to go to the detail for two other especially cystic equine focuses, which is prevalent in all of the world. Echinococcus granulosus is the tapeworm, tiny tapeworm, just a few millimeters, living in the intestine of dog and other canids. And due to its importance, after utilization of molecular methods in the hematology, too many research has been done on the phylogeny of these parasites. And so far, we have from G1 to G10 genotypes. Do you know what it means, genotypes?
Mm-hmm.
You see that I say, right, for example?
Genetically different types of the species.
Pardon?
Genetically different types of the species.
Yes. When I say Echinococcus granulosus, this is the genus, granulosus is a species for both single and plural is the same. Okay, when the species have differences inside the species, there are differences in the genetic, it is called genotype. So it is actually a subgroup related to a specific species. So for Echinococcus granulosus, so far we have 10 genotypes from G1 to G3. G means genotype. The most prevalent one in the world is G1. Okay, actually it is happening between dog and sheep. Sheep is one of the most important intermediate offspring. Sheep is very susceptible to this species, genotype. Both in the herbivores and also in humans, the most prevalent species in the world is G1. The G1 to G3 are called Echinococcus granulosus sensu stricto or SS, but all the genotypes G1 to G10 are called Echinococcus granulosus sensu lato or SL. Afterwards, when I say Echinococcus granulosus, I use the germinal term. I mean any species which is affected in human. So when I'm speaking about the clinical aspect treatment, we don't know the genotype, which is what is the genotype. I use the general term, I mean any species infect human. Just I want you to know that how these parasites have some very variation inside the species. Right.
Sensu stricto and sensu lato, is it just the difference of name and genotype or?
No, when function? I say sensu stricto, it means just G1, G2, G3. But when you say sensu lato, all of them, G1, 2, G3, G1,
just
2,
name.
3, 4, just the name. Just don't forget about it. I'm not going to the detail. Right. This is the geographical distribution of Echinococcus granulosus. You see how widely it is distributed in all the world. Any country you are coming from, if you look to the map, you can find you have this problem. We have also problem in Iran, in neighboring countries, especially in the Middle East. It is one of the most important parasites in the Middle East. It is in China,
also
in Australia, in North and East Africa, and even in Iran we have in all provinces. We have this difficulty in all provinces.
Mm-hmm.
But the rate of the prevalence is different. Right. Definitive host.
Yeah.
Definitive host of Echinococcus Definite house of Echinococcus granulosus or canids. Dog is the most important because human has close relationship with dog. But any canids, even the wild life, and also felids act as definitive host. We have both domestic canids or wild canids, such as fox, wolves, coyotes. All of them may be infected with a kind of Echinococcus granulosus. Intermediate hosts are herbivores, both domestic and wild. Actually, a Echinococcus granulosus has a wide variety of intermediate hosts. Any herbivores, sheep, goat, camel, or wild herbivores, moose, kangaroos, all of them may be intermediate hosts. So what is the role of human in this life cycle between carnivores and herbivores? Like other animals which act as intermediate hosts, human get infected with the larvae of Echinococcus granulosus.
Hello. What is the meaning of hoofed animals?
Hoofed, it means in Farsi we say charpayan, for example, horse.
Charpayan.
Cow.
Cow, yes. I want here to show you that we have both domestic life cycle and wild life cycle. In the domestic life cycle, the life cycle is between dog and sheep, alright? But in the wildlife, for example, in the Australia, dingo, the jungle dogs is called dingo. Between the dingo and kangaroos, the life cycle is happening, kangaroos and dingo. So, a wide variety of domestic, this is the hoof animals.
Okay.
So, we have those wild and domestic. But humans get infected mostly through the contact with the life cycle, the domestic life cycle, right? So, let's see how humans get infected. How humans get infected with the source of infection, the form of the parasite which infects human is egg. Like the clip I showed you, egg with the oncosphere, with the embryo, egg with the embryo which is called oncosphere.
And six
oncosphere is the name of the embryo in the system. Oncosphere is the name of the embryo in the system.
You told me.
So the egg with the embryo is the form of the parasite which infects human. So digestion of the egg, alright, either through the direct transmission with the dog or canids or indirect. For example, by eating the contaminated vegetables, carrot, pica, some children actually have the behavior of eating pica and water, any food which is contaminated with the egg. Egg are released through the intestine of the definitive host or the dog. So when the dog is infected, the eggs are released in the environment. By the contamination of the environment, human get infected by digesting of eggs. So geophagia is a risk factor. Or people going in the jungle by eating wild berries, they are at the risk of infection. Here I want to show you some risk factors. Ownership of livestock, mainly dogs, sheep, pastoralism, agricultural activities, they are risk factors. Uncontrolled slaughtering and poor hygiene are important risk factors. You see here, I'm sure you have seen such practices.
Yeah.
Here, in some endemic areas, for example, in some rural areas of Iran, after the slaughtering of this intermediate house, the viscera is eaten by the dog. So the dog is infected. Or here, this viscera at the actual consumption of the dog, so dog gets infected. Human and other intermediate hosts get infected by digesting of the egg. Egg produces the larvae in the intermediate host, like sheep and other herbivores. This viscera containing the larvae of echinococcus when it is eaten by definitive host in the intestine, they develop to adult echinococcus granulus. This is the adult Echinococcus granulosus, just a few millimeters, 3 to 8 millimeters. They have scolex with 4 suckers, 2 rows of small hooks. This is the neck, this is immature prolotis, mature and gravid. This is gravid prolotis, this is the genital cord, which is lateral, and the legs of the gravid prolotis is nearly at the same size of the half of the whole length of the body. This is the adult, this is the terminal gravid prolotis full of eggs, you see? These are the eggs. This is part of the intestine of dog, heavily infected with echinococcus. Why the number is too much? Because the size is very small, the size of the adult. This is the morphology of egg. All the cystoids inside the egg have an embryo with 6 booklets. But the morphology of the layers is different. For example, for all tinea species and for all the echinococcus species, the inner layer, which is called embryo fold, is very thick and striated. A dark striated embryo fold, which is around the embryo or endosphere. The size is about 30 to 40 micrometers. Tomorrow I'm showing to you. This is the larva. Okay. The larva of Echinococcus granulosus has a specific name because it has a specific structure. Actually, the cysts of Echinococcus granulosus are spherical, you see, they are spherical, and inside the cyst is full of fluid, and hydative, it means originally it's in related to water. Okay? So, spherical cyst, full of fluid, okay? They have several membranes. This is a liver of an intermediate host infected with hydatid cyst. This is the cyst. The main cyst, the original main cyst is called mother cyst. Inside the mother cyst, there may be several small cysts which structurally are similar to that of mother cysts, except they are smaller. You see, they are smaller. So they are called daughter cysts. Usually in human, the size of the cysts are about 5 to 10 centimeters, this size. Usually 5 to 10 centimeters, but they may reach as length of 30 centimeters at the size of, nearly the size of the football ball, soccer ball, okay, this big. of the hydatid cyst. I want to show you different layer. This is the normal tissue of the host, for example, human. Here you can see, which is adventitious layer of the fibrotic tissues of the host. Okay, host. But here the layers related to the parasites starting. The green part, which is thick, is called laminated layer. Laminated layer is multi-acellular layer. It don't have any nuclei. The laminated layer. Okay. Through the inside, here the pink part is called germinal layer. Germinal layer is very important because they have stem cells. They have germinal cells, okay? From the germinal layer, some broad capsules develop inside the fluid, okay? This is broad capsule. In the broad capsule, several scolices develop. Each scolix is called protoscolix. So inside the broad capsule, we have several protoscolix. Protoscolix. Or the plural is protoscolices. This is singular, this is plural. So we have laminated layer, which is thick acellular layer, germinal layer. From the germinal layer inside the fluid, we have broad capsule. Inside the broad capsule, there are some scolices. Each scolices is called protoscolix. Protoscolix may be found free floating inside the fluid. Okay, what is the difference between this broad capsule and this one? This is broad capsule, but if we have a structure similar to the main cyst, except it is smaller, it is called Doppler cyst. It means Doppler cyst has laminated layer, germinal layer, broad capsule, scolices. So it is structurally similar to the main cyst. Alright? So we have fluid, we have protoscolix, even in the broad capsule or Doppler cyst. We have broad capsule, we have free Doppler cyst, all of it. That's the reason each cystode has different name for the larval stage, because structurally they are different. Alright? So when we say metacystode, it's a general name, larval cystode. But each one have a specific structure. Hydatid cyst is a spherical cyst from about 1 centimeter. More than 30, but usually in human between 5 to 10, they have different layers. In the human, the layer around the cyst is called adventitious layer, fibrotic layer, due to the host response to the presence of parasite. The parasites have laminated layer, germinal layer, broad capsule, Doppler cyst, protoscolices, and fluid. The fluid of the hydatid cyst is very energetic in man. They may produce local urticaria, or they may even lead to anaphylactic shock, leading to death of the patients. That's the reason this parasite is very important. This disease is very important. Anaphylactic shock may be after the destruction of the disease, or even during the surgery. The surgery of this disease is very crucial. It needs expertise team. Otherwise, it may lead to the death of the patients, even during the surgery. That's the reason why this disease is so important. Here you can see some actual picture of the actual picture of the cyst. This is the liver, this is the vitrea, this is fibrotic tissues related to the host immune system activity. This is laminated layer, this is germinal layer, these are broad capsule. Every of these spores is called protospores. Here you can see broad capsule, high density protospores, germinal layer. You know, the germinal layer, when we stand, for example, here by hematopoiesis, is darker than laminated layer. Can you tell me why? Why germinal layer is darker than laminated layer?
Because in germinal cells, which are dense.
Because the laminated layer doesn't have any nucleus.
Yes.
But germinal layer is stem cells. Many nucleus, and they get darker after staining by hematopoiesis or periodic acid sheet or other stain in the histology. Okay, this is the liver of a sheep. The liver of a sheep infected with hepatitis cyst. It has been provided from a slaughterhouse. After the slaughter in the hog, with the sheep. If we actually drain the fluid of the heart disease and pour it in a conical glass container, after several minutes, we can see some sediment at the bottom of the container resembling the sand. Actually, this sand is included of the cyst content. Protospores, broad capsule, delta cyst, special protospores. A fertile cyst, when I say fertile, it means they have protospores. Estrile, it means they don't have. In unsuitable intermediate house, usually they are estrile. But in suitable intermediate house, for example, in the sheep, G1, in human, G1, they are actually, they have many protospores. So, because especially protospores resemble the sand, the other name is hydrated sand. So, hydrated sand is the other name for protospores. What is the structure of protospores? One head embedded in a body with four suckers, hooks and suckers. When the head is embedded, it's called invaginated. When the sporex is moving out to out, it's called evaginated. So, hydrated sand is the other name for protospores. Protospores, presence of the protospores in hydrated sand is very important. Actually, they have two behaviors. If a cyst like this one, full of protospores, is eaten by definitive host, by dark, every single protospores develop to one adult in dog. Okay? That's the reason why that dog was how many infected? Heavily infected. You see, there's too many in one actually cyst. There may be millions of protospores. So one such cyst is eaten by dog, every single protospores develop to one adult in the intestine of dog. But in human, if protospores or part of germinal layer during the surgery move to other part of the body through circulation, they lead to secondary cyst. So that's the reason why the surgery of hepatitis cyst is so crucial. cycle of echinococcus granulosus. First, I want you to have attention here. Human is an accidentally terminated host. You know, the presence of human in the life cycle is not necessary. Why I'm so emphasizing on this issue? Because if we find the infected human patients, we treat them, all is very good for the patient, but it doesn't affect on the control of the disease in the nature. Okay? Because in the nature, the disease is happening between canids and herbivores, both in the domestic cycle and wildlife cycle, right? So for the control of the disease, we need to use strategies for the control disease in the definitive host and intermediate host. Human is an accidental intermediate host. It means the presence of human in the life cycle is not necessary. Okay, the life cycle. Dogs and other canids, definitive host, the adult living in the small intestine like other cystodes, the terminal troglodytes and the eggs are released in the environment when the eggs containing the embryo is eaten by the intermediate host. The eggs develop to the larval stage, which is called hydatidiasis, in the internal tissues of intermediate host. When this liver or other organs full of protosporuses are eaten by definitive host, every single protosporus develops to one adult in the intestine of definitive host. That's the life cycle. How human get infected? Human, like other herbivores, get infected with the hydatidiasis through the ingestion of egg containing the embryo, either close contact